Hello there, BookTube. Oh, should make sure that I balance the audio. If anyone was wondering why I occasionally click at the beginning, so I can balance the audio. I record the audio separately from the video, and then I layer them on top of each other, because, as you may have noticed in some of my very, very early videos, I had an awful microphone. It picked up loads of background noise, and I had to then put it through loads of filters. Some of my early videos, the ones where I didn't show my face, those were with that old microphone. And it's so terrible that when I tried to filter everything out, I ended up having to filter out levels and levels of treble. So the bass is boosted heavily and the pitch is changed. So my voice ends up coming across unnaturally low pitched. I know that's true on my top 10 books video, for example. There's a couple of others where the same thing happens. It's to a different degree on each video, depending on how much background noise there was. But yeah, it was worrying. It was a problem. The microphone in this camera is not too bad, but I actually record the audio as a separate audio file. It's just better that way. But that's not the point. That's not why you're here. So there's been a heat wave in the UK. It's been hot, and it's only getting hotter. The last weekend was very hot, with Sunday being the hottest day this year. And this coming weekend is due to be hotter, with Saturday and Sunday both predicted to be hotter than the previous Sunday, and the heatwave to continue through Monday, Tuesday and Wednesday. So it's looking like it's going to be one hell of a weekend. It's Friday today. It wasn't so bad midweek. Like, it cooled down a little bit on Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. Those 3 days we were still mid to upper 20s, but it was cooler than it was when it was breaking 30 degrees. Now, this is something that I've spoken about before, because when you tell people on the internet that there's a heat wave and it's now 30 degrees, or even like 27 degrees, which is still uncomfortably hot. When you say that on the internet, first of all, Americans haven't got the faintest clue what you say, because they all use Fahrenheit. It's the only country in the world that does use Fahrenheit. I don't know Fahrenheit, and I'm not going to bother to learn it for one country. Be like the rest of the world. Use the same unit that everyone else uses. It's annoying. Anyway, 30 degrees C. That's not very hot. Not when Texas, India, South China are regularly going above 40 degrees. 45 is not unreasonable. I believe in China, on the southern coast of China, it was hitting 50 degrees this week. That is the case in some parts of California, Texas, some parts of India, the Middle East. I know that it's very hot for a lot of people. And when they hear the temperatures up here, they go, that's sweater weather, what are you talking about? And I'm like, yeah, for you it is. And the thing is, I can walk around outside at 10 degrees in a t-shirt. Can you? Because I guarantee you can't. I guarantee you'd be freezing your bollocks off in that kind of temperature. But 10 degrees C, it's cold, but I can put up with it. Because I'm used to it. I'm used to temperatures getting cold. I'm used to them getting very cold. Temperatures below zero don't bother me that much. Like, I can put on a warm jumper, a warm jacket, and I'm fine. But I guarantee you get those same people who, you know, go on and on about how, oh, this isn't real heat. They would freeze their arses off. And the fact is that we are sensitive creatures. Humans. We are very, very sensitive to temperature. Our species acclimatizes slowly over time. And then once we've acclimatized to temperature, deviation from that temperature becomes very, very difficult. It's why my sister, who has been living abroad for years, is going to come back to Britain and is going to find it way too cold for her. She's been living in the tropics for 5 years. She's going to come to Britain, and she's going to be in this frozen wasteland from her perspective, whereas I'm going to look outside and I'm going to say, this place is boiling. It's all a matter of perspective. Now, I would go a step further. There's a reason that heat waves have been declared. Warnings have been declared across Britain. And that's because we have a heat at the moment that is about 15 to 17 degrees higher than the national average. It only takes about 10 degrees above your area average before you are at risk of heat stroke. I had heat stroke last year. It was not pleasant. I have an air conditioning unit that I made a point of going out of my way to buy last month. Or was that the month before? This year, anyway. I bought it recently. I bought it specifically because I was expecting a heat wave this summer. And if it hit me, I could end up in hospital or even dead. Because I had heat stroke. And it was only because I emptied out bags of ice from the freezer and basically sat hugging bags of ice when the ambulance arrived. They said, if you hadn't done that, you would probably be going to hospital right now. We couldn't guarantee you'd have made it. That's how bad it was. So yeah, heat stroke kills. It's deadly, and it does not, you do not need to be that hot to get heat stroke. You just need to be hotter than you're used to. So for me, 30 degrees could kill me. 30 degrees would be normal everyday weather for someone who lives in Florida or California. If you're living on the South Island of Japan, this is going to be normal average temperature. If you're living out back of Australia, 30 degrees is positively cold by your standards. So, yeah, that's what you've got to remember, is that temperature's relative. Anyway, the heat wave does bring to mind one very, very important thing, and that is the Old West. It's not really very important, but the Old West is what it reminds me of. And the reason it reminds me of that is that I have recently been buying some books, so I thought, let's talk about some books. I've bought a few new books, and it was largely inspired by June on the Range, which is a booktube thing that's been happening. June on the Range is a read-along thing that was happening last month that I missed. I missed it because I was doing my own thing. I wasn't really in the right space. But I've been watching some of the videos. I've been watching some of the videos that have come out in July about June on the Range. And I'm really intrigued. I've never really sat and read Westerns. The first I got exposed to Westerns was reading Cormac McCarthy. And I know for a fact that there are various people taking part in June on the Range that would consider that to be a travesty of an introduction to the genre. Now, I've watched Westerns. I've watched films. I like a fair few. I kind of like the way Tarantino approaches the Western. He does unconventional Westerns like Django Unchained and The Hateful Eight, which are still Westerns in the way that they're done, but he turns the genre on its head a little, subverts it a little. And that's fine. That's fun. I've enjoyed a few others. I remember watching an Australian Western when I was a kid, Quigley Down Under, which I always enjoyed. It was a really fun film. It was one of my favourite films as a kid, and it was one of the only traditional style hero in the West, or in this case in the Outback, just being a hero, rescuing the damsel and stopping the bad guy, that kind of thing. Quigley Down Under was a good film. I highly recommend it. Tom Selleck just being a badass. But yeah, I still haven't really experienced much in the way of Westerns, though. So I have gathered a few based on recommendations I've seen. These are what I would say are the top three most recommended Westerns that I've seen on the June on the Range videos that I've watched so far, and the various different posts and discussions that I've noticed people talking about. So, first of all, I have an OK Corral novel. Apparently the OK Corral is something that is regularly delved into. It's Doc Holliday and Wyatt Earp, those characters. Apparently they're public domain characters that loads of people have written. So when I went in trying to find the first Wyatt Earp or Doc Holliday novel, I couldn't find which one should be the first. So if you know where I should start to get the basis of these characters, by all means, let me know. But this was the book that seemed to be the most recommended of the OK Corral stories. And that's Epitaph. Epitaph by Mary Doria Russell. This is a book that I'm looking forward to giving a chance to. It's not unreasonably long. It's no bigger than the average fantasy book. So I should be able to get through that quite comfortably. I bought this. It was advertised as new. It's got a tear in the cover. But other than that, it's not so bad. I can back this in plastic like I did with some of my other books. And it'll be fine. It's not worth complaining. Though I do wish people, when they sell secondhand books, would not list them as new when they're clearly not. Right. Though, admittedly, I don't think it's ever been read. The spine isn't curved or broken at any point. The pages are perfectly clean. So, other than the tear on the cover, it is pretty much as new. But that's Epitaph, which I'm looking forward to giving a chance to. I know the OK Corral is just a story about a gunfight and the aftermath of that gunfight. That's all I know about it. And there's characters called Doc Holliday and Wyatt Earp. I don't even know what happens to either of them. So that'll be intriguing to follow along. Next, I have True Grit. Now, I think I've seen the film. And I say I think because I may have watched it whilst either half asleep or drunk when I was much younger. Though I think the film's fairly recent. I don't know exactly when it came out. I know that I think it was Hayley Steinfeld was in it when she was still a child actress. And she's in her mid-20s or something now. So it can't be more than 15 years old, I'd say. Which would put me still in my 20s. So God knows when. I must have been like half asleep or something. Or maybe it was on in the background while I was doing something else. But I'm vaguely aware of True Grit, and I've got a few images of the film in my head. All I know is that this is a story about a young girl who decides to hire the meanest, nastiest guy she can to get revenge for her dad. That's all I know about it, and it's got a quote from Roald Dahl on the back, which I would not have expected Roald Dahl, of all people, to be the person quoted on the back. It says, True Grit is the best novel to come my way for a very long time. What book has given me greater pleasure in the last 5 years or in the last 20? What a writer. Interesting. Don't generally see Roald Dahl quoted. But anyway, True Grit. This is probably going to be the first one I'm going to read because it sounds interesting. I know the premise. The premise sounds very intriguing. Like a revenge plot with a young girl hiring the meanest, nastiest guy she can find. That sounds like it's going to, you know, result in great drama, great hijinks. Also, this book is diddy. It is a tiny little thing. So I reckon I can read through that quite quickly. Like, we're looking at, little over 200 pages. So, a little under 200 pages. It can't be particularly long. What, maybe 300 words per page? At 200 pages, that's maybe 60,000 words? That's tiny. That is genuinely tiny. That is small enough that I could reasonably read that in a day. A whole day, but a day, nonetheless. I'm going to enjoy that, I think. It's maybe 5 hours worth of reading. I could whack that out on a weekend without much issue. The next one is very much the opposite. This was the most recommended book for Lone on the Range. It was the one that most people spoke about. It was regularly spoken as someone's favourite. At least 3 different people have named it their favourite. And those that didn't, hadn't read it and were really looking forward to it. So, that book is Lonesome Dove. This was Steve Donohue's favourite in the genre. And it's one highly rated by Brian Lee Durfee. It's been spoken about by a few others. I know Michael K. Vaughan has read this for the first time this summer. And I know that it is about some not necessarily washed up, but older men who used to be on the frontier in the West. They're now settled down in a town called Lonesome Dove. And they decide that things are getting boring, things are getting a bit stale. And for some reasons, I'm not sure exactly what the reasons are, I haven't read it yet, they pack up everything and they cattle drive up north to Montana. And the entire book is following them on this cattle drive. Loads of different things happen, different storylines branch off as different people are involved in the cattle drive. And we're talking a cattle drive at a time when that would have been genuinely dangerous. So I'm expecting some excitement, some adventure. I'm expecting good drama, good relationships. I hear this has a really, really good male-male friendship that is well-written and well-regarded. It's the thing that people remember about this book the most. I've been told it's a really good, that one very, very well-focused female character in this. I'm not sure what her name is, I can't remember. But again, something to look forward to. One thing that this is, though, is a fucking doorstop. This is one hell of a size book, especially when you compare it to True Grit. So, this is closer to the size I'm used to, at 843 pages long, and way more dense text than True Grit as well. This has way more words per page than True Grit. Like, I was estimating 300 words, I didn't count them out. I was estimating 300, but usually a book has somewhere between 250 and 350 words per page. I estimate about 300 on this. I would be much, much closer to the 350 on this one, I think. I don't know how many words Lonesome Dove is, but I would be surprised if it was less than 300,000 based on looking through that book. It is a massive book. And I don't know what to expect from it, because the storyline doesn't sound complicated enough to justify the page count. So I'm excited to hear what happens. I'm excited to go through it. It's going to be one of those ones I'm going to have to put on the back burner for a bit, because a book that size takes some time. It takes some dedication. I can decide to just pick up True Grit and read through it and just devote a weekend to it, and it's not going to make any difference to me. But if I pick up Lonesome Dove, that's me done for the next, 3 weeks as I, get through all of this. Like, this is not something I'm going to be able to just crank through in a couple of days. So those are the three books that I've got here to introduce me to the literary genre that is the Western, because I've not really given it much chance. And I don't like the writings of Cormac McCarthy. I'm okay with his stories, but his writing I really don't like. So I haven't had any real luck with the genre, but I like it in films, so I should give it a try. So yeah, that's Westerns. Hopefully some others will be entertained enough to give a couple of these books a try, see what they think, and maybe we can chat about it. If you do want to chat about them, you can join me in Gilded. The link's always in the description below. We can talk books and other geeky shit. Until next time, I'll see you then. Bye.